going to give you a rundown on the history of the Centurion. This will be my first YouTube video on tank history. I am a massive tank nut and a bit of a history buff, so I'm going to give this a go. If this format works, I'm hoping you guys will let me know, and I'll keep on doing it for tanks that interest me and hopefully interest you as well. So the way I plan on doing it is trying to show you as much as the history I can through the tech tree in World of Tanks, so it's a bit relevant to World of Tanks players. And if there's a tank in Armored Warfare that interests me and I can show you the history of it through tech tree in Armored Warfare, I'll do that as well. But I'm not a huge War Thunder fan, so I won't go into War Thunder. But if I can do it in the tech trees of World of Tanks and Armored Warfare, I'll definitely do it. So the first tank I wanted to talk about was the Centurion, probably my favourite tank in the game, the whole Centurion family. So without further ado, we'll get into it. So the Centurion design was commissioned in 1944 or 45, early 45 I think, by the Ministry of Defence, and it basically called for a design of a tank that was neither a cruiser tank or a infantry tank. So basically it was a tank that was a mix of both a cruiser tank and an infantry tank. So a cruiser tank was a tank that basically was a hit and run tank, so it was quick, light, agile, punchy gun, quick firing gun, used to run ahead of the line, hit the enemy where it least expected it, back away. An infantry tank was a tank that was designed to support infantry, so it moved at infantry type pace. For example, the Churchill was a classic infantry tank. Whereas when you look at the cruiser type tanks, it was more the Cromwells, the Comets, the Crusaders, the Covenanters. They're all cruiser type tanks. So the Centurion was designed to kind of bridge the two of those. So it was a tank that could support the infantry and a tank that could had a bit of speed about it and a bit of punch to it. It was the first time the words main battle tank had been used for a tank, and I guess it was the term was used to delineate between an infantry tank and a cruiser tank and what the Centurion was intended to be. But the Israelis were to find out, much to their disappointment and chagrin, that the Centurion was in no way a main battle tank a little bit later on in its life, and we'll get to that a little bit later on. I think it was the A-41 was the design commission. I think it was called the A-41. There was 20 of them built in 1945. I think 6 or 8 of them made it to the front line the month the war ended. So I think the war ended in May, in Europe ended in May 1945. I think they might have made it in either late May or early June, so they didn't make it in time to see any real action in World War II. But basically it was this tank here. This is the tank that is considered to be the first Centurion. It's a there was 20 of these built. There was 5 with this Paulson 20mm cannon, the 77mm gun. In the back here, well, it's not depicted on this model, but there is a BSA machine gun in here. There were 5 built with this escape hatch, the Paulson 20mm cannon, and without the BSA machine gun. There were another 5 built with the BSA machine gun in here, replacing the Paulson cannon, and a 17-pounder gun, which became the Mark I Centurion. So the A-41 had the 77mm and the Paulson cannon, and the Mark I had the 17-pounder gun. The Paulson cannon was supposedly an anti-personnel type gun, but it was a pretty much a dismal failure. certainly wasn't designed to be a ranging machine gun. I don't know whether you know, but a ranging machine gun is used to fire short bursts of rounds out and gauge the range for firing the main gun. So it wasn't designed as a ranging machine gun, it was designed as an anti-personnel gun, and it was pretty much a dismal failure. The Paulson is based on the Oerlikon machine cannon, 20mm machine cannon, popular in the Navy. So that's basically the Mark 1 / A41. The Mark 2 had the 17-pounder gun on. Oh, I've got to fit the other turret to do that, so bear with me for a moment. So this was basically the Mark 2. Had the... I've got to put the tracks on, for Christ's sakes. All right, fair enough. The Mark 2 had this turret, even though it called it a Mark 3 turret. It was a fully cast turret and the 17-pounder gun. So that was the Mark 3. Sorry, the Mark 2. The Mark 2 had the first, had a BSA machine gun here, but it was the first ranging machine gun to be used. It wasn't an anti-personnel machine gun, it was a ranging machine gun. So that was the Mark 2. The Mark 3 had the 20-pounder gun, which is the 20-pounder A barrel, so that's basically the Mark 3 with the bigger gun. The Mark 4 was a bit of a weird tank. It was a infantry support tank. It was designed purely for infantry support or close-in support. And it was basically, let me go to back to the Cromwell to explain. It was basically, wait for it, that gun, which is the, what do they call it here? Yeah, the 3.7-inch howitzer gun, the derp gun on the Cromwell, as we know it, fitted to the Centurion. So it was the derp gun on the Centurion, which made it the Mark 4. So it was, I don't think there was too many instances of that tank around. It was deemed wholly unsuccessful, and they didn't continue the line too much at all. Then we get to the Mark 5, which is interesting because it is actually, I'll go out of here, the Mark 5 is actually this thing. This is actually the Mark 3 / Mark 5, depends on the turret fittings and the baskets on the back of it, but this is was known as, well, went to the Swedish Army, and it was known as the STR V82 or 84, I think. They took a delivery of 200 of them. Sweden, Australia, Israel, and India were the first countries to take delivery of the Centurions outside the UK. Previously, the UK government did not sell tanks overseas at all to anyone. But the Centurion was the first tank to be sold to other armies around the world, and it was snapped up by just about everyone. So this became the STR V82 or 84, and basically the derivatives of the Centurion remained in the Swedish Army up until about the year 2000. They upgraded them and upgraded them, and they eventually become the equivalent of about the Centurion AX Mark 10, Mark 11s, Mark 12s, and become known as STR V102s. But they were heavily upgraded, and they just kept on buying more and upgrading them and upgrading them until they got to a tank that carried them through to 2000. Somewhere around about 2000, 2001, I think they retired their last one. Of course, at the same time, we had a shipment of, We had a shipment of Mark IIIs coming to Australia, but they were diverted by the Brits to the Korean War, and they were used by the Brits in the Korean War, so we never took a delivery of the Australian Centurions until late 1950s, early 1960s. We took delivery of the Mark IIIs and immediately converted them to Mark Fives by putting on this extra armor plate here and the giant fuel tank at the back, and we used the B barrel 20 pounder with the counterweights here and the two ranging machine guns. There was a 50 cal and a 30 cal ranging machine gun in here, and the counterweights on here, which look like iron sights, but they're actually counterweights for the ranging machine guns. This is, of course, the Australian Mark 5-1 in the game. Probably my favourite Tier 8 tank at the moment. Used by Australia, saw action in the Vietnam War. Famously described as a real people killer. There was instances of this tank being driven up to buildings. They fire an armor-piercing shot into into the building through the wall, and then drove the tank up, put the barrel through the hole, and fired a canister round into the thing, just basically killing everyone inside. A canister round is an anti-personnel round filled with what they call flechettes, which are tiny darts, which they fired, and of course the darts fly out on firing, and they just turn everything basically into liquid in front of them. So, but very, very deadly weapon. The 5-1 was used by the Australians in Vietnam, and we went on to use them and took delivery of the Leopard in, I can't remember, that was 1975 or 76, I think, maybe a little bit later, 79, something like that. The Leopard 1 replaced the Centurion 5-1 in our army. Pardon me. So it's the Centurion 5-1. The Centurion 7 was the Centurion 5-2 was also a tank that we picked up on in the Australian Army as well. We had one of these fitted with the 105mm L7A1 gun. We used a few of our Centurion 5-1s and turned them into 5-2s by fitting 105s to them, which kind of made them somewhere between a Centurion 5 and a Centurion 7. One of our Centurion 3s, by the way, was used in nuclear testing. It was basically put almost near at ground zero, about 500 yards from ground zero on a nuclear test, blown up and basically driven off the test site, and went later on served in Vietnam. It was basically cleaned up, washed out, done everything to it, fixed it all up again. Apparently they drove it off the range site, and it actually sits as gate guard now in Darwin. One of the gate guard Centurions in Darwin is actually the nuclear test tank. On to the Centurion 7. Now, just about every derivative of the Centurion up to the Centurion 13 was basically just an upgrade of everything from a Centurion 6 onwards. So Centurion 7-1 was upgraded Centurion 5s. The Centurion 13 was actually upgraded Centurion 6s with infrared sighting, range and guns, and resilient mantlet. I'll show you what the resilient mantlet is a little bit later on when I get to the Centurion AX. But basically everything up to the front from about the Centurion 7 or the Centurion 8 all the way through to the 13 were just upgrades of basically existing tanks by upping their armor, upping their engines, upping their armament, and changing the rear deck layout, changing the hull layout a little bit, and they just kept on upgrading them. So if you look at the Centurion 10, when they talk about a resilient mantlet, this is what they talk about with the resilient mantlet. It's basically a one-piece turret with no mantlet, like the 7-1 or the 5. You can see that all of them have got actual mantlet, whereas the Centurion 10 doesn't have a mantlet as such. It's got what they call a resilient mantlet, which is part of the turret, I believe. So what was I going to say about the Centurion 10? This is basically the tank that the Israelis took, and from about the Centurion 7 up, they took and they turned them into what they called the SHOT, the SH'OT, or is it SHO'T? The Centurion SHOT, SHO'T, I think it is, which is basically Hebrew for whip. And they used them with great success in things like Yom Kippur, the Six-Day War, and a number of other battles. When they first used them, though, and I think it was, I can't remember whether it was a Six-Day War or whether it was the Yom Kippur, they learnt pretty quickly that these things were by no means the modern version of a main battle tank. So even though they were called a main battle tank, they did not stand up well to man-portable ATGMs, so anti-tank guided missiles. They had a massive amount of loss. I think they lost about 20% or 30% of their Centurions to man-portable and what they call suitcase-type ATGMs, anti-tank guided missiles. They lost an awful lot of tanks, Centurions in particular, to basically anti-tank missiles fired by, so RPGs, RPG-7s, I think they were called SAGAs, the suitcase missiles that they fired, but they lost like 20 to 30% of their tank force to people carrying RPGs, and that's when they realised that in the true sense of the word, the main battle tank hadn't been invented yet. Even though people thought that the Centurion was a main battle tank, it could not stand its own against man-carried anti-tank guided missiles. So it led to the design, or the Israelis designing the Merkava, which is a true MBT, but it also has the ability to carry 4 infantry in the back of it, and we'll talk about that a little bit later on. So you'll see that the Centurion, although not an MBT, it actually led to the design of some very, very effective main battle tanks. So it's kind of the mother of the first main battle tanks, if you like. So out of the Centurion project also came what they called the 40-ton Centurion. We know it as the FV4202 in the game. This is what's called, or better known as, the 40-ton Centurion. It has the resilient mantlet. It also has the redesigned lower or upper hull. And it's the first tank to have a semi-reclined driver position. And it was actually the test bed for what became the Chieftain hull. So this tank is basically a hybrid of a Centurion and a Chieftain, if you like, known as the 40-ton Centurion, for obvious reasons. It was supposedly 40 tons, and It was a derivative of the Centurion. Moving on from that, we got to, and this is where I need to leave the World of Tanks game, we got to the first of the true main battle tanks, and I'm about to flash up a picture for you of that now, just one moment. Where is it? It is here somewhere, trust me. Not that. Here we are. So, this... Oops. What the hell? Why'd you do that? That's wrong. One moment, please. I don't know why I've done that. File system error. That's handy. There it is. That is the Chieftain. That is the probably the first true main battle tank ever built. This is a Chieftain Mark 11, I would say, because it's got the steel brew armor on it. This tank was designed not only to take a shot from other tanks, but it was also designed to be resistant to anti-tank guided missiles, down to, at the time, we call these things side skirts. They called them bazooka plates at the time. They're still known as bazooka plates in the British Army, apparently. But it's designed to basically withstand RPGs, withstand suitcase ATGMs, and take a shot from a tank. So take a shot from T-55s, T-54s, T-10s, all those tanks of the day. It was designed to take a shot from them, as well as withstand heat projectiles from ATGMs, which basically what ATGMs are. They were basically explosive warheads, heat explosive warheads. So that was the Chieftain, which then led on to the Challenger 1. I should go back and point out this is the tank that the Israelis designed to overcome the issue that they encountered with the Centurion. So if you like, the Centurion is also the mother of this tank. This is the Merkava. I don't know what model this is. I don't know whether that's a Mark 1 or not. I don't think it is, but it's probably a little bit later than a Mark 1, but I just found the first picture of the Merkava I could. And this is what I wanted to show you about the Merkava, is this area in here, which is packed to the gunnels with shit, but that's actually an area for four infantrymen to be carted into battle with the tank crews. So basically these guys would support the tanks in action. It was front engine, so the engine had to move from the back to the front, and it was set to the driver sat to the left-hand side of the engine, so he got protection from anything on the right-hand side. He was protected by a damn huge engine block. Anything from the left-hand side, well, he was basically fucked. The other thing about it, of course, is if it didn't carry infantry in, it could carry tank crews out if a tank got incapacitated and they couldn't get them out, well, they could still get the crews out by chucking them in the back of another Merkava and can't transport them off the field. So the Centurion was the mother of this tank as well. Actually, probably the mother. Certainly she's the grandmother of the mother of the Chieftain, so she'd be the mother of the Merkava as well. Challenger 1 is the probably 1980s, 1990s MBT of the British Army. And that went on to, of course, the great Challenger 2, probably in my opinion the finest main battle tank. Oh, hello, I've got a few of those open. Minimise that. I'm going to try and minimise this now. I want to show you a picture of a Challenger 2. I can't find it. style fixture I'll drop out of this. There's a Challenger 2. That to me is the finest example of a main battle tank in production today. Still in use with the British Army. Wonderful tank. So that I think is basically the history of the Centurion. There's probably a heap of stuff I've missed, but feel free to make comment in the comments of the YouTube video. Feel free to correct anything I've said and let's have a discussion about it. pardon me. Yeah, that's about it. Look, thank you very much, and we'll see you in the next video. Thanks. Bye.